إن الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فهذا أيها الإخوة أول مجلس من مجالس القراءة والتعليق على هذا الكتاب المبارك، وعنوانه يعرف برسالة ابن القيم إلى أحد إخوانه، رسالة ابن القيم إلى أحد إخوانه. فهذا الكتاب اللطيف من تأليف الإمام الجليل العلامة الرباني ابن القيم رحمه الله، أو ابن قيم الجوزية، وليس هو أبا الفرج ابن الجوزي الذي توفي في آخر القرن السادس، لأن بعض من لم يعرفهما يخلط بينهما. الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله توفي سنة 51 و700، وقد تكلمنا عن سيرته وعن حياته في مجلس خاص، فلن نعيده هنا. This is the first lesson of these lessons in which we read and comment on this book, which is a blessed book, Mubarak. And its title is known as, among the people of knowledge, it's known as Ibn al-Qayyim's letter to one of his brothers. Ibn al-Qayyim's letter to a brother. And thus, this book was authored by the great Imam al-Allama al-Rabbani Ibn al-Qayyim, also known as Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. And he's not أبا الفرج الجوزي، أبو الفرج الجوزي، أبا الفرج ابن الجوزي، عفوا، أبا الفرج ابن الجوزي، who died when at the end of the 6th century. ابن الجوزي died in the end of the 6th century. Because some people who don't know them, sometimes they mix between the two. الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله died what year? No. He was born 690 something. 691. 751. He died 751 Hijri. Rahimahullah. And we had a lesson in which we spoke about his life in brief and his seerah. And inshallah, it gets translated soon and uploaded. وأما الكتاب فعنوانه كما ذكرنا رسالة ابن القيم إلى أحد إخوانه، وسمي بذلك لأن الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله أرسل رسالة إلى أحد إخوانه، إلى أحد أصحابه إخوانه، يذكره فيها بالله وما له، وينصحه في جملة من المطالب المهمة التي يسعى إليها كل مسلم. ونستطيع أن نقول إن مضمون هذه الرسالة جملة عن تزكية النفس والسير إلى الله، وما ينبغي أن يعامل الله به، وما ينبغي أن يكون عليه المسلم. وأما تفصيل هذه الجملة فستتضح بالقراءة إن شاء الله تعالى. As for the book, as we mentioned, its title is what? Ibn al-Qayyim's Letter to a Brother. And that's the title of it, because Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah, he sent a letter to one of his friends, to one of his brothers. And he was reminding him of Allah and advising him on a number of things, a number of significant matters, and things which every Muslim strives for. And thus, we can say that the general topic of this letter is heart purification, or soul purification, and manners in our journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and things that every Muslim should be upon. That's the general topic of this letter. As for the specifics of that, then it's going to become clear, inshaAllah ta'ala, as we read. وهذا الكتاب في الحقيقة ينبغي لكل مسلم أن يعرفه ويقرأ ما فيه يعرف ما فيه ويقرأه وأن يدرس ويقرأ للناس في المساجد فإنه كتاب جليل قد حوى على صغره فوائد عظيمة ووصايا مهمة بل هو من أصغر كتب الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله التي وصلتنا ولهذا يحسن لمن أراد أن يشرع في قراءة كتب الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله أن يبدأ بهذا الكتاب ثم يرتقي إلى غيره لأن هذه الرسالة كالخلاصة والمدخل لعلوم ابن القيم رحمه الله لأن الأمور التي تكلم عنها في هذه الرسالة قد بسطها وقررها ووضحها في كتبه الأخرى رحمه الله فيمكن أن يشرح هذا الكتاب بما ذكره في كتبه الأخرى فيشرح هذا الكتاب بكلام ابن القيم رحمه الله نفسه ولكن هذا يحتاج إلى تتبع إلى من يستقرئ كتبه ويعرف ما فيها وليس ما يفعل اليوم من مجرد البحث في البرامج والقص واللصق. This book in reality, every Muslim should read it and know what's in it. Every Muslim should read it and know what's in it. In fact, it should be taught and it should be read in the masajid of the people. Because it's significant. It's a significant book. And despite its small size, it contains a great number of benefits. It contains great benefits and important advice. In fact, it's one of the smallest books of Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah that have reached us. Because there's other books for him rahimahullah, but we don't have the manuscripts for those books. So they're missing. There's books he wrote that we don't have. And alhamdulillah, by the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is one of the books that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed reaches us. And another benefit of this book is that the one who wants to get started with the treasure that Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah left behind, which are his books, and someone has the high motivation to start reading them, then this is a good beginning point. It's a good book to start with. one of the first books that he should begin with. And then he progresses to higher books. Because this risala here, it's like a summary and an introduction to the knowledge of Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah. Because the things he spoke about in this, he spoke about also in other books. And he spoke about it there in more depth. And he established them. And he, in general, he spoke about it in more length. And thus, in fact, someone can take this book, which is his letter, and he can explain it through the words of Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah himself. That's possible. If he goes through his other books and he sees which topics he covered here, and then he goes to his other books and sees how he spoke about those same topics in more depth, and he makes it an explanation for this book. So you explain this book through the words of Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah himself. However, this of course needs someone who's serious and someone who's able to do that type of research. And someone who knows the books of Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah. And it's not like some quote-unquote students do today, where all you do is you search in some programs that have made accessing knowledge easy. You search in some programs and you copy and paste everything and that's it, and it's called a book. فهذان أمران ذكرناهما يظهر بهما حسن الاعتناء بهذا الكتاب وسبب اختياره. الأول هو مضمون الكتاب وهو تزكية النفس كما ذكرنا وما حواه من الفوائد على صغره وسهولة فهمه حيث ينتفع به الخاصة والعامة. لأن بعض الكتب التي ألفها الإمام ابن القيم رحمه الله أو بعض المباحث التي ذكرها في كتبه قد لا يفهم ما فيها حق المعرفة ولا ينتفع بها حق الانتفاع إلا أهل العلم. ولو قرأها العامي أو الطالب المبتدئ فإنه يضيع أو لا يفهم كثيرا منها. والأمر الثاني كما ذكرنا أن هذا الكتاب كالمدخل لعلوم ابن القيم رحمه الله وكالمدخل لكتبه الأخرى. So these are two things that we've mentioned so far, which show the importance of giving concern to this book and the reason we chose it as well. The first is what? Na'am. The first is the topic of the book and what it contains and the benefit it has despite how small it is. And it's easy to understand. It's easy to understand. The common person and the person of knowledge both benefit from it. Because some of the books that Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah wrote, or some of the chapters within his books, a beginner student of knowledge or a common person may not truly benefit from it. He doesn't benefit the way he should be benefiting from it. And he doesn't understand it the way it should be understood. And he doesn't truly understand it. And that's, if they were to read it, if a beginner student of knowledge or a common person were to read it, then he'll get lost. He'll get lost in those books and he won't understand most of what's in it. So that's the first. The second thing that we mentioned is that this book is like a small summary of the knowledge of Ibn al-Qayyim. and the things that he mentions often in his other books. And it's a good introduction to his other books for the one who has a high motivation and wants to get started with them. والأمر الثالث وهو أن مؤلف هذا الكتاب إمام جليل من أئمة السنة وينبغي للمسلمين أن يعتنوا بكتبه رحمه الله وكتب شيخه كذلك شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية وأهل العلم الذين جاءوا بعد شيخ الإسلام وابن القيم عيال على كتبهما لا يستغنون عنهما ومن نتج من علمائنا فمن أسباب ذلك عنايتهم بكتب هذين الإمامين وأثر هذه الكتب ظاهر في كلامهم ومؤلفاتهم وقد قربت هذه الكتب أي كتب شيخ الإسلام وابن القيم قربت علوم السلف قربت علوم السلف وفيها من الفوائد ما ليس في غيرها وأذكر أني وقفت مرة على قول أحد العلماء وأظنه من علماء القرن الثالث عشر أو الرابع عشر لا أذكر المقصود أنه قال ما ذقت حلاوة العلم حتى قرأت كتب شيخ الإسلام وابن القيم وصدق صدق رحمه الله ومن جرب هذا عرف صدقه ومن لم يقرأ كتب هذين الإمامين في زماننا هذا أو قرأ ولم يفهم لأنه ليس كل من قرأ فهم فاعلموا أنه أجنبي عن العلم لم يشم رائحة العلم بعد فضلا عن أن يكون من أهله وعلى كل حال لا نريد أن نطيل ولو أخذنا نتكلم عن كتبهما ومنهجهما وما تميزت به وثناء العلماء عليهما لاحتجنا إلى دروس. We mentioned two reasons so far. We'll add one more reason. And that is, the third reason, is that the author of this book is one of the great imams, of the imams of the Sunnah throughout Islamic history. And the Muslimun, they should be concerned with these books. They should, and give it priority. They should give priority to these books, the books of Ibn al-Qayyim and the books of his Shaykh, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. And the people of knowledge who came after Shaykh al-Islam and Ibn al-Qayyim, they are dependent on their books. The people of knowledge who came after them are dependent on their books. And they can't do without them. And our scholars who have reached that level in knowledge, one of the reasons they reached that level is because they gave concern to the books of Ibn al-Qayyim and Ibn Taymiyyah. And the effects of these books are very clear in their words and their writings. These, you know how you say bread and butter? Something which is bread. These are bread and butter books. These are one of the bread and butter books because the ulama, they have certain books which are bread and butter. That's what they are concerned with. And these are one of them. The books of Shaykh al-Islam and Ibn al-Qayyim. And these books, they facilitated the knowledge of the Salaf for us. They facilitated the knowledge of the Salaf and it brought it closer. And there are benefits in them which you won't find in any other books. And I remember once I came across a statement for one of the ulama, and I think he was one of the ulama from the 13th century or the 14th century. I don't remember. And he said, I did not taste the sweetness of knowledge until I read the books of Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim. And that's true. That's true. And the one who has tried this knows the truth of this statement. If you've tried this, you know the truth of that statement. That you start to taste the sweetness of knowledge through their books. And as long as you haven't dived into these books, Ibn al-Qayyim and Ibn Taymiyyah, then know that your knowledge has no depth. It's just surface knowledge. It's superficial. Superficial. And this shows, as I've said, and I've reminded over and over again, the importance of learning what? The Arabic language. The importance of learning the Arabic language. Because as long as you are distant from the Arabic language, you will be distant from knowledge. You will be distant from knowledge. And any knowledge that you happen to gain through other than Arabic will only be superficial knowledge. It has no depth to it. It has no depth. You won't taste the sweetness of knowledge until you get to these types of books. And the one who doesn't read them, in our time, this is in specific, I'm referring to the books of Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim, the one who doesn't read them, or he reads them but doesn't understand them, because not everyone who reads what? Understands. Whoever doesn't read them, or reads them and doesn't understand them, then know that he is foreign from knowledge. He still hasn't even smelled knowledge, let alone be one of its people. على كل حال, we don't want to spend too long talking about it, because if we wanted to talk about the books of Ibn al-Qayyim and Ibn Taymiyyah and what distinguishes them and the way, their way in writing their books and the praise of the scholars for them, then we would need lessons and lessons and lessons. فنبدأ إن شاء الله تعالى. طيب بما بدأ رسالته رحمه الله. What did he begin his letter with? بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فبدأ رحمه الله بالبسملة تأسيا بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. فإنه كان يبدأ رسائله ب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم كما في الحديث الصحيح بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من محمد عبد الله ورسوله إلى هرقل عظيم الروم. So he began with بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, and in that he's following the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, in the way he used to begin his letters, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For example, in the known hadith, authentic hadith, when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wrote a letter to who? Hiraql. To Hiraql, he started it with what? What was the beginning of it? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, min Muhammad, abdillahi wa rasulih, إلى هرقل عظيم الروم. To, from Muhammad, Abdullah wa Rasulih, to هرقل عظيم الروم. And he used to begin his letters with that, صلى الله عليه وسلم. يقول رحمه الله, الله المسؤول المرجو الإجابة أن يحسن إلى الأخ علاء الدين في الدنيا والآخرة. الله المسؤول المرجو الإجابة، وهذا من آداب الدعاء، وهذا من آداب الدعاء، وهو أن يدعو الله وهو يرجو إجابته، لا أن يدعو وقلبه فارغ وقلبه غافل، لسانه يتحرك وقلبه غائب، فأنى يستجاب له. فمن أسباب إجابة الدعاء أن يدعو العبد ولسانه وقلبه متطابقان، أن يدعو وقلبه حاضر يرجو إجابة الله سبحانه وتعالى. وقد قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: ادعوا الله وأنتم موقنون بالإجابة. قال الله تعالى: وقال ربكم ادعوني أستجب لكم، وقال تعالى: وادعوه خوفا وطمعا. فمن أسباب إجابة الدعاء أن يصحب الدعاء هذه الأعمال القلبية التي يحبها الله سبحانه. ولهذا قال عمر رضي الله عنه: إني لا أحمل هم الإجابة، وإنما أحمل هم الدعاء، فإذا ألهمت الدعاء فإن الإجابة معه. فإذا ألهمت الدعاء فإن الإجابة معه. He began his letter and he said, what? الله المسؤول المرجو الإجابة. Meaning, Allah is the one who is asked and his answer is hoped for. Allah is the one who is asked and his answer is hoped for to be good, to be kind to the brother Ala al-Din in the dunya and the akhirah. So he began with what? With what? A dua for this friend of his brother that he's sending this letter to. And he said, Allah is asked and his answer is hoped for, that he kada kada kada. And this is one of the manners of dua. One of the manners of dua is that you ask Allah and you hope for the answer. That you hope for the answer. Not that you ask Allah and your heart is empty and your heart is inattentive. The tongue is moving, but the heart is absent. The tongue is moving, but the heart is absent. And this is something that should be taken into consideration when you're making, for example, your adhkar after the salah. Some people, their tongue is moving. Why? Why? Because the heart isn't there. The heart isn't there. So how do you expect an answer? How do you expect an answer like that? And thus, one of the causes for your dua to be accepted and answered is that you call upon Allah and your heart and tongue are in compliance. They are in agreement. You're asking Allah and your heart is present. And this is something which is in every single form of worship as well. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, make dua to Allah while you are convinced of the answer. You should be convinced that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ اُدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. And your Lord said, call upon me and I will answer you. And he also said, subhana, wad'uhu khawfan wa tama'a, and call upon him with fear and hope. And call upon him with fear and hope. And thus, one of the reasons that your dua is answered is that your dua is accompanied with these actions of the hearts that Allah loves. Your dua is accompanied with actions of the hearts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. And that's why Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, I'm not concerned with the answer. Meaning, I'm not concerned that my dua will be answered or not. Meaning, he's convinced that it will be answered. He says, I only have the concern of the dua itself. Meaning what? Meaning to be inspired to make the dua. He said, and thus, if I'm inspired to make the dua, then the answer is with it. The answer is with it. So that shows conviction. Conviction. قال أن يحسن إلى الأخ علاء الدين في الدنيا والآخرة. To be kind to the brother علاء الدين in the dunya and the آخرة. وسبب إحسان الله إلى العبد في الدنيا والآخرة هو إحسان العبد في العمل. فإذا أحسن العبد في عمله أحسن الله له الجزاء والثواب. وهذا الإحسان في العمل يندرج تحته الإحسان فيما بين العبد وبين ربه والإحسان فيما بينه وبين الخلق. الإحسان إلى المخلوقات. فالله سبحانه يجزي على الإحسان بالإحسان كما قال تعالى هل جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان. فمن أحسن في عمله أحسن الله إليه في الدنيا والآخرة. فهذا دعاء عظيم من الشيخ لهذا الأخ. ومن أدبه رحمة الله عليه ورحمته ومن حسن الأخوة لأنه افتتح رسالته بالدعاء لهذا الأخ. وليس كما يفعل بعض سفلة الخلق اليوم يحيي بعضهم بعضا بالشتم واللعن. He said what? To be good to the brother, Alaeddin in the dunya and the akhirah. Allah's goodness, the cause of Allah's goodness to a person is His goodness and actions. Al-Ihsan, perfection and goodness and completeness of your actions. So Allah's kindness and Ihsan, His Ihsan to a person, is a result of his ihsan in his actions. And al-ihsan in your actions is of two types. Ihsan in you dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ihsan in what is between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And ihsan to what? To the creation. Ihsan to the creation, even to animals. And thus, the reward of ihsan is ihsan. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Rahman, هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. Is there any reward for ihsan except ihsan? And thus, the one who performs that ihsan in his actions, Allah carries out that ihsan towards him in reward, in, as a recompense. And thus, this is a great dua that the Shaykh rahimahullah began with. And he shows his manners and his mercy with his companion and his brotherhood with his brother, began his letter with this great دعاء. And we know that Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah has a greater status than him. He is greater in his knowledge, and he is an imam. And this is the dua he's making for his brother, as opposed to some of the low lives of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of the low lives, the despicable ones, they may even begin their conversations with insults to each other and cursing each other. And I don't want to give examples, and I think, you know, hey, you, I think you guys know what I'm talking about. This is some of the lowest of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Begin talking with each other as the introduction to the conversation is an insult and cursing each other. Subhanallah al-azim. قال رحمه الله وينفع به وينفع به ويجعله مباركا أينما كان. And this is the end of his dua. وينفع به ويجعله مباركا أينما كان. And to benefit through him, meaning, and I ask Allah to benefit others through this companion of his, this brother, and make him mubarak wherever he is. To benefit others through him and to make him mubarak wherever he is. وَيَنْفَعَ بِهِ لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى قَدَّرَ الْأَشْيَاءِ بِأَسْبَابِهَا وَجَعَلَ الْخَلْقِ يَنْفَعُ بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا فَمِنْ تَوْفِيقِ اللَّهِ لِلْعَبْدِ أَنْ يَنْفَعَ اللَّهُ الْخَلْقَ بِهِ وَيَجْعَلَهُ مِنْ أَسْبَابِ الْخَيْرِ وَأَعْظَمُ النَّفْعِ أَنْ يَنْفَعَ اللَّهُ بِهِ فِي بَيَانِ الْحَقِّ لِلنَّاسِ وَهِدَايَتِهِمْ إِلَى رَبِّهِمْ ونهيهم عما يعود عليهم بضررهم في دنياهم وأخراهم. وهذه هي وظيفة الرسل. وهذه وظيفة الرسل. وقد ذكر المؤلف رحمه الله بعض الأمثلة لهذا النفع الذي يجريه الله على يد من يشاء من عباده. قال ويجعله مباركا أينما كان. البركة كثرة الخير ودوامه، فالمبارك الذي هو الذي بارك الله فيه، المبارك ما بارك الله فيه، لأن البركة إنما هي من الله، لأن الخير كله في يديه سبحانه وتعالى، فالمبارك من جعله الله كذلك بأن يجعل الخير متصلا به. ولهذا قال المؤلف هنا ويجعله مباركا أينما كان. وهذا الوصف غير مختص بالعباد، بل قد يكون المكان مباركا، وقد يكون الزمان مباركا، وغير ذلك، لحصول الخير واتصال المنافع به. What did he say? And to benefit others through him and to make him blessed wherever he is, to make him mubarak wherever he is. That's the end of that first sentence. That's his dua. To benefit others through him. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he decreed things through what? Through causes. Causes. He decreed things to take place through their causes. And thus, one of the signs of tawfiq from Allah for a person is that Allah benefits the people through him. He makes that person a cause of good. A cause of good. A cause for good to reach the people. And one of the greatest ways of benefiting is to clarify the truth to the people and guide them to their Lord and forbid them from that which harms them in this life and the next. And this is the duty of who? Of the prophets and the messengers. And this was the duty of the prophets and the messengers. And then the author, rahimahullah, he mentioned some examples of how Allah benefits others through a person, which will come, insha'Allah ta'ala. And this is fadl from Allah. He chooses whom He wills through His wisdom from His servants and makes them a source of benefit for others. And then he said, and to make him mubarak wherever he is. To make him mubarak wherever he is. What is al-barakah? What is barakah? Huh? I'm not asking for translation. Huh? Jayyid, very good answer. Huh? Al-barakah kathratul khayri wa dawamuhu. It's an abundance of good and a continuation of it. That's what barakah is. It's when something contains a lot of good and it's continuous good. Thus, al-mubarak, something is mubarak, then it's what Allah has made a source of barakah. Something is mubarak, Allah has made it mubarak. Allah has made it like that. Because barakah is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Barakah is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because all good is in His hands. All good is in His hands subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we said barakah is what? Huh? An abundance of good and a continuation of it. So the one who is mubarak is the one who Allah made that way. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By making good attached to him. Good is attached to that person. So he is mubarak. And that's why the author said, and to make him, you know, so Allah make him mubarak. And this description of being mubarak, is it only restricted to people? Huh? What else could be mubarak? A place could be mubarak. Huh? Na'am, time, a certain time can be mubarak, and other things as well. Why? Because good is attached to it, and because of the benefits associated with it. The good and benefits associated with that thing. وهنا سؤال إذا كانت البركة كثرة الخير وثبوته ولزومه ودوامه فهل يقال في حق الله مبارك؟ Question. If we said that, if barakah is an abundance of good and a continuation of good, then is Allah described as being mubarak? Huh? Do we say Allah is mubarak? Huh? Allah, you don't say about Allah mubarak. لا يقال مبارك وإنما يقال تبارك الله. يقال تبارك الله كما وصف الله نفسه في مواضع كثيرة من كتابه. قال تبارك الله رب العالمين. تبارك الله رب العالمين. وتبارك على وزن تعاظم تعالى تبارك. ولا يقال في حق غير الله إنه تبارك كما يجري على بعض ألسنة الناس. لا يقال هذا في حق غير الله سبحانه تبارك. هذا الوصف مختص بالله فهو المتبارك. You don't say about Allah he is مبارك, but you say تبارك الله. تبارك الله. And Allah described himself through that. He described himself through that in many places in his book. For example, تبارك الله رب العالمين. تبارك الذي بيده الملك. And so on and so on. So تبارك is on the weight of تعاظم, تعالى, تبارك. And it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described himself through that. And it is complete, complete barakah and vast barakah, tabarak. And that's why no one is described through that except Allah. You don't say to anyone, innahu tabarak. This is a description which is specific to only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال رحمه الله فإن بركة الرجل تعليمه للخير حيث حل ونصحه لكل من اجتمع به. قال الله تعالى إخبارا عن المسيح وجعلني مباركا أينما كنت. وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ. He says, indeed, the barakah of a man is him teaching good wherever he is and advising everyone he meets with. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, informing about al-Masih alayhi salam. Who's al-Masih? Isa. Isa ibn Maryam. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed about al-Masih, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ. And he has made me mubarak, blessed, mubarak, wherever I am. He has made me mubarak wherever I am. وقال هذا عليه السلام وهو في المهد كما أخبر تعالى فأشارت إليه قالوا كيف نكلم من كان في المهد صبيا. قال إني عبد الله آتاني الكتاب وجعلني نبيا وجعلني مباركا أينما كنت. ثم فسرها المؤلف رحمه الله فقال أي معلما للخير داعيا إلى الله مذكرا به مرغبا في طاعته. عيسى عليه السلام, he said that, when did he say that? Yeah, when did he say that? نعم, when he was a baby. In the cradle, he said it. عليه السلام. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed in Surah Maryam. فأشارت إليه. And so she pointed to him, meaning his mother, Maryam. And so she pointed to him. And they said, how can we speak to one who is in the cradle, a child? And then he spoke. And that's one of the miracles of Isa alayhi salam, that he spoke as in the cradle. And he said, قال إني عبد الله آتاني الكتاب وجعلني نبيا وجعلني مباركا أينما كنت. And then the author rahimahullah, he explained what that means. And he said, meaning a teacher of good, calling to Allah, reminding of him, encouraging his obedience obedience to him, encouraging obedience to him. وهذا التفسير كما فسرها بعض السلف كما فسرها بذلك بعض السلف. And this is how some of the Salaf, they explained this a statement of Isa. And he made me Mubarak wherever I am. They said that he is a teacher of good and a caller to Allah and so on and so on. The things that we mentioned.
قال رحمه الله فهذا من بركة الرجل.
He says, and thus, this is from the baraka of a man. This is from the baraka of a man.
ما هو من بركة الرجل?
What is it that it is a from the baraka of a man? نعم. Teaching the people good, calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reminding of him and so on.
قال فهذا من بركة الرجل لأنه ينتفع به من اجتمع به وجالسه فمن بركة العبد أن ينفع الله به غيره فيما يقربهم إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى وهذا لا يكون إلا لمن انتفع بالخير في نفسه فيسري بذلك خيره إلى غيره يسري خيره إلى غيره وبهذا يتبين أن أعظم الناس وأكثرهم بركة الرسل والأنبياء أن أعظم الناس بركة هم الرسل والأنبياء ثم الأمثل فالأمثل فبركة المسلم إنما هي على قدر اتباعه للرسل بركة المسلم إنما هي على قدر اتباعه للرسل فمن كان لهم أشد اتباعا وأتم موافقة كان أعظم بركة
He says, and this is from the baraka of a man. The things that we mentioned. Why? Because the one who sits with this person and mixes with this person, what? Benefits. They benefit through him. And thus, one of the signs that someone is Mubarak is that Allah benefits others through him in the things that bring them closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a sign of his barakah. And this is only for someone who has benefited through that himself. Yani, do you think that someone's going to be Mubarak and he's benefiting others in the things that bring them closer to Allah and he himself hasn't benefited inwardly? Never. Never. And thus, the person of barakah, he's benefited himself first and foremost. And then that good which is within him has spread to others. That's a barakah. And we said barakah is an abundance of good. So he benefited himself first and foremost. And he himself is good. And then that good spreads to others. And through that, we understand that the people who are greatest in their barakah are who? The prophets and the messengers. Because no one is more beneficial for the people. No people are more beneficial for the people than the prophets and the messengers. And no one is more merciful to the people of the people than them. No people are more merciful to the creation than the prophets and messengers themselves. And then comes those who follow them. Those who are followers of the prophets and the messengers. And thus, the barakah of a person is only through following the prophets and the messengers. It's only through following the prophets and the messengers.
It's according to how much you follow them. The more you are in accordance with the prophets and messengers, the more you are Mubarak.
And thus, the one who is most in compliance and most in adherence to the prophets is greater in barakah. And of course, the people differ in how Mubarak they are. فهذه بعض علامات من كان مباركا. ثم ذكر المؤلف رحمه الله علامات من محقت بركته. من محقت بركته. وليزن العبد نفسه ولينظر إلى أي الفريقين هو أقرب. Thus, he mentioned now just some signs of a person who is Mubarak. And then he now speaks about the signs that someone is void of barakah. Someone who has no barakah. And that's what he's going to talk about. And thus, a person should weigh himself. See, which group am I closer to? Am I closer to this first group or am I closer to this second group? And that's what we're going to talk about next week, inshallah. Someone whose barakah has been eliminated and void. In fact, he's so void of barakah, if you mix with him, your barakah goes away. And we're going to explain why, inshallah ta'ala, next week. نذكر هذا إن شاء الله تعالى في الدرس القابل. نقف هنا وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه.